If you're visiting, we're very thankful that you're here, and exciting because of the promise that Jesus made, where two or three gather in my name, I'm in their midst. And if we've gathered in his name, then it's a very exciting. You think that the Lord himself is here with us. Now, we're living in some interesting times. I think we're living in what you would call the last days, which is exciting. Some might find it frightening. And we see things that are happening in the world today politically. Just last week, Russia technically invaded the Ukraine. And we see things that are happening in the world religiously. How many of you are aware about the Pope's message that was played at that charismatic gathering? Let me see. Show me your hands if you've seen that or heard the video. Did any of you see it with my commentary?
Yes.
Oh, good. Well, you must be some of those 600,000 people that have clicked either on YouTube or Facebook. We were really shocked. And if you know if there's anyone left, just let them know. And so that's important. Some people said, are you going to talk about that today? Not any more than what I've just said, really. I'll tell you why. In listening to the comments and reading some of the banter related to that, it is very significant. I think there's prophetic implications. It's another step, a landmark prophetically, things we always knew were going to happen. And for me, you know, the Pope's recent appeal for unity, that came a few days after I was at a religious broadcasters convention about a week ago in Nashville, and at the conclusion of this convention, where you've got leading religious programmers from around the world that were there. We even met some who do our programming in India that were there. And the last message was given by Jack Hayford, who is a fairly well-known evangelical minister. They were giving him a Lifetime Achievement Award. Any of you ever sung the song Majesty? Well, he wrote that. He's a charismatic pastor, very sincere man, but his message was that we need to put aside the divisions and the barriers between the denominations and all love and unite together. And it was a lot of the same kind of thing that we'd been heard coming from the Vatican this week. I mean, it sounds good, but when you really dissect what's involved in that, it can be troubling. It basically says at the expense of truth, we should lay aside any of the truths that divide us and just embrace each other on the things we hold in common. So while I was thinking about those things, I thought it'd be very important to talk about a very simple principle in the Bible for Christian living, and that is of forgiveness. Both accepting and passing on forgiveness. If you would make it to the kingdom, we need to receive God's forgiveness, and we need to share God's forgiveness. And we may need to receive it more than once. That's tongue-in-cheek, of course you do. And you're going to need to share it more than once. Maybe even with the same person. Now, my favorite story to illustrate this truth is found in the Gospel of Matthew. And I think you only find it here. Matthew 18 is a parable Jesus gives, and I'll start with verse 21. Matthew 18, verse 21. Then Peter came to him, to Jesus, and said, Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Up to seven times? Now, why did Peter say that? First of all, he noticed that Jesus was very forgiving. The religious leaders in the time of Peter, scribes and the Pharisees, they pretty much thought that God forgave people in a major way three times, something like baseball, that after three strikes, you're out. And you could look at, you know, King Saul. You can point out three great areas where he rebelled against God, ultimately going to the witch. But with David, he only had two strikes with Bathsheba and numbering Israel, and so he could be forgiven. And so they actually had developed a theology that God forgives three times. But Peter noticed how forgiving and merciful Jesus was, and he thought, well, I ought to double that because he is so merciful. and maybe add one because it's a nice biblical number, and say seven times. And he maybe expected Jesus to say, "Oh, Peter, that's very kind of you. You're finally getting the message." Or even to think, Peter, he might have said, "You're going a little too far." Six times or four times, seven. But Jesus answered and he said, "I say not unto you seven times, but 70 times seven." Now, part of the reason Jesus, or Peter, might have said to Jesus seven times, you know, Mark 16, verse 9, it says, "He appeared first to Mary Magdalene, out of whom he cast seven demons." And Peter had read where it says in Proverbs 24, 16, "A righteous man may fall seven times and rise again, but the wicked will fall by calamity." He might fall seven times and rise again. Job 5, verse 19, "He will deliver you in six troubles, yes, in seven, no evil will touch you." So there are these different verses. He thought seven was a good number, but Jesus didn't say seven. He said 70 times seven. Why did the Lord say that? Does God have a ledger in the sky where he chronicles how many times we kneel and ask for forgiveness? And when he gets to 490, then it's curtains. Do you have that with others? If you're a parent, where in the continuum of time did your children reach 490? Did you then, your forgiveness dry up at that point? You know, it's interesting that when Daniel was praying in chapter 9 and saying, "Lord, how long until the Messiah comes?" I mean, look at it. We're here in Babylon. We're captives because of our disobedience and our sins. You read that whole prayer of Daniel 9. He's basically saying, "I'm amazed at your mercy, your long-suffering, your mercies never end. You're still willing to forgive. How long until the Messiah comes?" And he says, 70 times 7. 70 weeks are determined upon thy people. What's a week? 7 days. 70 times 7. And really, and it wasn't 70 times 7 times of forgiveness, but he's talking 490 years of forgiveness. Most of us don't live that long. So really, it's an unlimited number. God is willing to forgive as often as we are willing to genuinely repent. Now, when I say that, I always like to issue a disclaimer and qualify it. Do not take God's abundant, never-ending mercy presumptuously to think that because he's so merciful and willing to forgive, that I can just continue to plan on sinning and repenting. Because while God is willing to always forgive, if you're willing to really repent, you can lose your capacity for repentance. You can numb your own conscience by taking God's mercy for granted. So it's not the problem that he's going to run out of forgiveness. The problem is you may run out of conviction and the desire to be forgiven. We all know people when they first come to the Lord, how God's working in their lives and they're convicted about their sin. And then sometimes you do a check with them 20 years later and they're still going to church, but they still have that same sin, but it doesn't bother them anymore. You can get to the place by presuming on God's mercy that you lose the ability to repent. And so then Jesus follows up with a parable. And so if you continue reading here in Matthew 18, he says, "Therefore the kingdom of heaven," I'm in verse 23, "the kingdom of heaven is like a certain king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. And when he had begun to settle accounts, one was brought to him who owed him 10,000 talents. Now, kings would often, they would contract with different people in their cabinet to be responsible for the taxes in different districts. And if you were like the king of Persia, who had 127 provinces, you might have 127 different tax collectors that were responsible, and they were paid handsomely. But eventually there was some bookkeeping that was done, and this man who was brought before the king, he had been responsible for the king's money, and instead of raising money, he had run up the royal credit card. He not only had not been collecting, but he had squandered 10,000 talents. Now, to understand that, I read a commentator last night, Adam Clark. He was from England. Adam Clark said, if it was gold, a talent is a weight. So we don't know, is he talking talents of silver or talents of gold? And if it was talents of gold, he said, that would exceed the national debt of the British Empire. And he wrote that when the British Empire was all around the world. It could represent, one talent of gold would represent a year's wages for a well-paid individual. 10,000 talents would be 10,000 years. Even Methuselah couldn't work that off, right? So the number that's being picked here is an astronomically absurd number. It's a debt, the point Jesus is making. This is a debt that cannot be paid back. At least the individual can't pay it back. Now we might wonder, how can somebody possibly squander 10,000 talents of the king's money? You know, you start looking at what the government does, and it becomes more believable, doesn't it, after a while. $300 for a hammer or something. Y'all remember that report that came out? And as he was not able to pay, his master, the king, commanded that he be sold with his wife and children and all that he had, and that payment be made. Now, this was a pitiful scene. You know, he's brought out. They get the books. He shows the books. It's in black and white. You can't escape the data. And he realizes there's no excuse, and he says, can you pay this? He said, no, I can't pay that. And he said, okay, hand him over according to the law. He hands him over to the law. According to the law, all that he has is to be confiscated. And if that's not enough, and it certainly will not be enough, his house is to be stripped, his house is to be sold, his family is to be brought in, his wife is to be sold as a slave and part of someone else's harem. His children are to be sold as slaves. And while the whole family is in there suffering the consequences now of his debt, it's a pitiful scene. They're crying and there's weeping and wailing and daddy, daddy. And the man falls down before the king and he says, please have mercy on me. Have compassion. Have patience with me. I will pay it all back. What are the chances he's going to be able to pay it all back? It's absurd. But you read on, and it says, the servant therefore fell down before him, saying, master, have patience with me, and I'll pay you all. And the master of that servant had compassion. It says he was moved with compassion. And he released him. Now, the word compassion is different from the word pity. Compassion means, comes from the word, like when you say sympathy or pathos, it means to feel what another person feels, trying to relate to feel what someone else feels. And you know, it's like the government tells us, I feel your pain. I have my doubts. But I believe God does. And that's something that Jesus, it says he was moved with compassion at the people because they were hungry. So he fed them. He felt what they felt. The king is moved with compassion. His heart is moved. And he released him. He says, okay, undo their handcuffs. Let the family go. And he forgave them the debt, meaning, he said, all right, you can have your house. You can have your things back. I'm not setting up a payment program. I'm writing next to your name, forgiven. And I am going to freely forgive what's happened here. Well, how would you feel? Do you think that man just woke up one day when he was called to the royal court and found out, oh, I've wasted $10,000. I had no idea. Or do you think he knew about it? He knew about that debt. It was probably crushing him. Yeah, it's probably all he could think about. You ever have bill collectors call you? You ever have your name get turned over to a collection agency? I did. It's been a long time. Our credit's good now, but years ago, I neglected to pay something, and boy, They haunt you and they dog you and it wrecks your credit. And I won't ask you for a show of hands. That'd be embarrassing. But can you imagine having a high-powered collection agency trying to get 10,000 talents from you? The burden that you're constantly thinking about. He couldn't do anything without thinking about it. Now, the king has said, forget it. You're free. That problem that's been crushing you for years, it's gone. How would you feel? I would have walked out of the palace on cloud nine. I would have been walking on air. I would have been skipping. I would have been so happy. Free at last, free at last. I would have been, wouldn't you have felt like that? you have that kind of burden, you've got a burden of 10,000 talents. Remember, that's a weight. You got 10,000 talents weighing you down. And then the king says, forgiven. You would have thought, yeah, you would have been jumping for joy. You would have been so happy. But instead of rejoicing, what does he do? This is where the story gets sad. It goes from just joy and exhilaration and happiness. It says, but that servant, he went out and he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii. That's about 100 days' wages. It's 100 days' wages if you don't make very much. That's 100 days' wages for the poorest people. A good worker could make it in a week. And he goes and he finds a fellow servant that owes him 100 days' wages. And he lays hands on him and he takes him by the throat. That's getting a little personal. And he says, pay me. He starts to choke him. Say, pay me what you owe me. Now, why is he doing that? Well, first of all, I don't think that he really believed that the king forgave him. He wouldn't have gone out and found someone else right away and said, pay me your $42 after he's just been forgiven $52 million. Why are we sometimes unforgiving with others? Maybe we don't realize how much we've been forgiven. Now, before I go any farther in this story, don't miss the very obvious lesson. That 10,000 talents represents our sins against the king. It represents a debt we can never pay. Before I was an Adventist, I used to go to a Pentecostal church, and there was a sister there who was a preacher. Her name was Clarice Toombs. And I remember she'd get up, get very excited when she preached. She'd kick off her shoes and say she's on holy ground. And she taught everyone a song, and it's, he paid a debt he did not owe. I owed a debt I could not pay. I needed someone to wash my sins away. And I thought, well, that theology is pretty good, actually. I owed a debt I could not pay. He paid a debt he did not owe. And so this man had a debt that he could never pay forgiven. This other fellow, he could forgive him. That 10,000 talents, I just used an illustration to bring it on another level. The distance between the earth is approximately, and the sun, 93 million miles. That represents God's forgiveness to us. Takes light about 8 minutes to get from the sun to the earth. 93, and that's going 186,000 miles a second. 93 million miles. Our sins, that 100 pence, $42, that represents our debts to each other. God is willing to forgive us the distance between the sun and the earth, and we are often not willing to forgive each other 1 foot. That's the kind of ratio that you find in this story. And God just forgives me the distance between the earth and the sun, and then I go take you by the throat because of 1 foot. When you stand at the foot of the cross and you see what Jesus is suffering for your entire life of sins against everybody, including heaven, and after he's forgiven all that, you see him bleeding for your sins, for you then to go take your neighbor by the throat because they gossiped about you, how do you think heaven views that? Is that appreciating the mercy? After God forgives me as much as he's forgiven me, it makes it a little harder for me to be hard on you. Unless I don't appreciate or believe he's forgiven me. See, if that servant left the king's palace thinking, all right, 10,000 talents, where am I going to get 10,000 to start somewhere? Where? He doesn't believe the king's forgiven him. And so he's trying to go collect from everybody else because he doesn't believe he's forgiven. You see how important it is to believe God forgives you? If you really believe God forgives you, it makes it so much easier to forgive everyone else. But if you don't believe that God has forgiven you, you're going to still be angry and brooding. I won't ask you to name any names, but I bet we all know some folks that are always talking negatively about others. There's one or two of them out there, right? You talk to them, they've always got kind of little caustic, nasty things to say about other people, and they're always pointing the finger at them. Do you see what they did? You heard the expression that when you got one finger pointing away, you got three more pointing back. But you know what's often happening? Pointing out the sins of others is often a diversionary tactic used by those who do not really believe that they're forgiven. they are still struggling with guilt for their sins, so they redirect the guilt by pointing out what everyone else is doing wrong. Always talking about what the church is doing wrong. And I've got a good list too, just like you. And they're always talking about what someone else in the church did and how the church is managing things wrong. And sometimes that's really just a cloak for it. They don't really believe God has forgiven them. And I'm not saying there isn't a time where we should be our brother's keeper and there is accountability and sometimes sins must be addressed. I'm not saying that. I'm saying a lot of time where we talk about what everybody's doing wrong and we gossip about others. You know, a lot of people have tried to cover up gossip by saying it's a prayer request. You got something you need to pray about. Listen to this. You know, you sort of sanctified gossip. We'll call it a prayer request. You know what I mean? He didn't really believe he was forgiven, takes his brother by the throat, and it's like he's getting even with him. It's like vengeance. Sometimes a person hurts you, and you think you're getting even by talking bad about now, we have all done things to hurt others. How many will admit that? We've all done things that have hurt others. Sometimes it's been deliberate. Sometimes we'll say something and we say, oh, I'm just kidding. And we weren't kidding. We meant for it to bite. Matter of fact, whenever someone says, they're just kidding, that's almost code for, no, I'm not. A lot of people say something a little bit cutting or, you know, whatever, and they're just kidding. Yeah, not. It even says that in Proverbs. Sometimes we'll say something, hurt someone, we'll say it was in sport. Solomon says, you know, it wasn't. And how many have been hurt by others? And some things that we do to hurt each other are very serious. And they're hard to forget. You know, sometimes we go through life, if you don't learn to forgive and you start making a list, it ends up hurting you. It ruins your experience. It's like an anchor. You're just never going to fly as a Christian until you can learn by God's grace to let go of these things, and you can't do it without His help. I heard a story years ago about this man back before Louis Pasteur discovered the cure for rabies. And you know, you got bit by a rabid animal back then. That you get what do they call hydrophobia, and eventually after a few days you sort of lose your mind and you start to rant and rave, and technically you're rabid. And if you've ever accused someone of being rabid, it means they're, you know, they're raving. So this man had, they just discovered that the animal that bit him was rabid, and the doctor said it's hopeless. And the man said, doctor, do you have a piece of paper and a pencil? He said yes, and he gives it to him, and he starts to furiously write. He said, you don't have to write so fast. If you're making out your will, you've got several days probably. He said, I'm not making out my will. I'm making out a list of everyone I'm going to bite before I die. And that's actually how some people think. The devil's like that. He's come down with great wrath because he knows his time is short, so he wants to take as many with him as he can. Instead of thinking about others, thinking about vengeance. And we've all got that kind of potential in our lives. We're to learn to forgive people the way Jesus forgave. There's a few verses on that. Proverbs 26, verse 7, whoever digs a pit will fall in it, and he who rolls a stone will have it roll back on him. Chinese proverb says, whoever chooses revenge really digs two graves. One for the person that you're trying to trap and one for yourself. When Haman got upset because Mordecai would not bow down to him, he built a gallows for Mordecai. He's so consumed with himself. Who ended up hanging on those gallows? Haman did. He was hung on the gallows he had prepared for someone else. And so, you know, one of the most important reasons to forgive is you just destroy your own experience. I remember hearing one time after the Civil War that Robert E. Lee, the famous Southern general, he was visiting one of these Southern belles. Actually, she was a more mature woman who had a plantation that had been just all smashed up by the Northern Army, and the house has been wrecked because they used it as a headquarters, and she had this beautiful oak tree that was up on a hill. It was perfectly symmetrical silhouette. She was telling Robert E. Lee, this tree was beautiful tree. It was hundreds of years old. And look at what those blankety-blank Yanks did to the tree. The cannon shot has just destroyed it. It will never look the same again. And she went on and on, and Robert E. Lee listened for a moment. He said, Madam, cut it down and forget about it. Because you can make a monument, if you want to something someone else has done to hurt you. And you could take it out and refresh it every now and then. And, you know, if you've got those little monuments in your life and letters you're saving, because you might use it as evidence someday, burn it, cut it down, let it go. You're dragging yourself down when you do that. You know, if you're born again, makes it a little easier to forget the offenses of what happened to that other person in another life. Because you're a new person. And you're a new creature. Forgive. Oh, but you know, it's pretty hard to forgive and forget. If you only knew. I'm tempted to tell you a litany of things that people have done to me. Or, you know, boy, and if I let it bother me what people said about me, I'd never have any peace. You can go online, I get a fresh dose every day if I wanted to. So you got to have a thick skin after a while. You just get consumed with that stuff. You just have to forget about it and focus on what God's plan is for your life. If the devil knows that he can distract you by what others are saying about you, you're never going to get anywhere. Because he'll always have somebody that will be talking about you. But there's more serious things. How do you forgive when someone maybe molested you in some way? That happens to little girls and little boys. How do you forgive when it happened to your child? That gets pretty difficult. I mean, you know, at some point we figure there's the unpardonable sin. And we draw the line and say, well, you know, God doesn't expect us to forgive that. I'm not talking about forgetting. Because, you know, it's only by the grace of God that any of us can go on with some of the painful things. We could ask for testimony time right now and say, I want you to tell me the worst thing that ever happened to you. Worst thing that someone ever did to you. That'd be an interesting testimony service, wouldn't it? Probably wouldn't be healthy. It'd be a long one. Yeah, and I'd try and top every story that you could tell. Which goes to show that while I've forgiven, you don't always forget. God casts our sins into the depths of the sea. And he really, like Isaac, looked upon Jacob and he blessed him as though he was the elder brother. God, he closes his eyes to our sins when we have the robe of Christ's righteousness. He forgives us, right? But it's not so easy. How do you deal with that? I remember reading about Clara Barton, who is a famous nurse and helper during the Civil War. And she was somewhat of a public figure, and someone had been saying some very unkind things about her. And another friend came over and wanted to engage her and said, well, have you heard what she said about you? She didn't comment. They changed it. But didn't you hear what she said? Aren't you going to answer? And she says, don't you remember what she said? And Clara Barton says, I distinctly remember choosing to forget. And you'll see, sometimes people will try to stir these things up. The devil might even use those near to you to try to grub up, muck up, as it says in Pilgrim's Progress, painful memories. Don't fall for that. Martin Luther said, you may not be able to keep the birds from flying over your head, but you can prevent them from making a nest in your hair. At least most of us can. The idea being that you can't help if a fleeting memory of something painful that's happened to you, it may go through your mind, but don't let it nest there. When you realize that it's happening, say, Lord, thank you for helping me forget about that. And then move on and overcome evil with good by thinking about something else. And you've just got to, you know, change your focus at that point. So back to our story. Parable doesn't end there. Finds his fellow servant, takes him by the throat, says, pay me what you owe. So his fellow servant, I'm in Matthew 18:29, his fellow servant fell down at his feet and begged him, saying, have patience with me and I will pay you all. Word for word verbatim what he had said to the king. Falls down before his friend just like he fell down before the king. Does the same thing. Now, If I own 10,000 talents, if I owed you 10,000 talents, you may as well just forgive me because you're never going to get it back. Unless it's 10,000 talents of, you know, dirt or something. I could probably find that. But if it's gold or silver, we're in trouble. But if I owed you $42, I'll bet you if I didn't have a penny to my name, I could find some resourceful, honest way to get that before the sun goes down. Or at least a couple days. I could pay you back. But this man would not forgive his friend, even after he begged him. I wouldn't get down on my knees if I owed you $42. I wouldn't like it very much if you took me by the throat. You realize what's happening here? His friend is being extremely humble. He's pleading for mercy. He's submitting. The other one is powering it over him, taking him by the throat. And yet we do that sometimes in our relationships when we don't forgive. And he would not. But he went and he threw him into prison until he should pay the debt. Now, you know what that prison is? We don't really have debtors' prisons in America now. We've got what you call chapter 11 and chapter 13 and chapter 7. We've got all these chapters that you file. If you can't pay your debts, there's several options. One is to reorganize if you're a business, and some you might just declare bankruptcy, and the court then will find out what assets you have and give you a certain amount to live on. And you don't want to file bankruptcy unless that's a last resort. But they didn't have that back then. And if you couldn't pay your debts, they had a prison. And in the debtor's prison, it wasn't like the American debtor's prison where they just lock you up until family or someone could pay it off. They actually could, some kings, if you had money you couldn't pay, they put you in a prison and they tormented you. And I guess they had a price list on the wall. It said, if you owe $50, 10 days on the rack, 20 lashes, something like that. But you were tortured every day. They kept you alive so you could suffer until they figure like you had suffered enough, or if someone in your family came and redeemed your debt. How would you like to go to a debtor's prison owing 10,000 talents? That would hurt. Right? That'd be pretty. You're not going to get out anytime soon. But he would not. Throw him in prison. Well, eventually, the fellow servants of the king, they knew this character that had squandered the king's money. They were aware what had happened. When his fellow servants, verse 31, saw what had been done, they were very grieved. And they came and told their master, the king, all that had been done. Does our king hear about how we treat each other? You know what John says? How do you say you can love God who you can't see, and you can't love your neighbor who you do see? One of the principal messages in 1 John, through all the Gospel of John as well, and 2 John and 3 John, my little children, love one another. You know what was the greatest testimony for the early church? Others that were not Christians wrote about the Christians, behold how they love each other. Paul said, but if you bite and devour each other, and are consumed of one another, is it possible to have a cannibal vegetarian? I mean, some of us might boast of being vegan, but we bite and devour each other with our words. That's what Paul is talking about. If we don't forgive each other. Now, how are we to forgive each other? To what extent is God asking us to forgive each other? Not only does the Bible say that you're to forgive one another, Jesus said you're to love your enemies. Someone wrote one time that it's interesting, God says love your enemies and he says love your neighbor. Could it be that God knew that our neighbor often becomes our biggest enemy? And neighbor is a nigh brother, and sometimes it's even those within the family. Boy, and I come from a rough crew of family. My mother and father had our wedding. They got divorced when I was 3. Even after 30-something years, they would not even get in the same pictures with each other. Always made me so sad. They had a fight right there at the wedding. I wasn't nervous about marrying Karen, but I was so nervous about my mother and father being in the same room. My mother and my grandmother didn't talk to each other for 9 years. It was just, I shared this message last time I shared it was in Romania in December. A man came up to me afterward. He said, God told you to share this message. I hope he's right, but he said, my father and my brother have not talked in years. And during the sermon, I wasn't sitting with my father, but we looked at each other, and I went, and he knew exactly what I meant. Needed to pick up the phone, call. They lived in the same town, went to the same church. They hadn't spoken in years. Love your enemy, love your brother. Sometimes there's a lack of forgiveness in marriages where instead of marriage being enjoyed, it's endured because there's an issue that has not been forgiven and there's been hurt. And you know, if you're married to someone long enough, something's going to happen. You're going to hurt each other because we're selfish creatures. And if you don't learn to forgive each other and to love each other, marriage will end up being something that is bitter and it's something that's being endured. And it might mean some confession needs to happen and a request for forgiveness. But you know what? Are you supposed to forgive someone that won't ask for it? Well, no, this is a very interesting study, and I don't have time to go into it all. Jesus says, if your brother comes to you, if he sins against you, forgive him. If he comes to you seven times in one day and says, I repent, you're to forgive him. But what if he sins against you seven times in one day and he doesn't ask? Well, first of all, I wouldn't hang out with him. But I still think you need to forgive him. Because, and if you want to have a happy marriage, you need to learn to apologize even when you think you're right. Can I get an amen? That's why I'm just going to stop right there. I mean, sometimes there's a disagreement, and you know you're going to have to respectfully agree to disagree, and you can say, look, I am really sorry. What you're saying is, I am sorry that we've had this disagreement. I love you. I want to get along with you. We may not always see this eye to eye. Sometimes you just got to hold your peace. And you just got to let it evaporate. Right? Just let it go. Isn't that right? Yeah, just forgive each other. And just doesn't mean you're always going to agree. Doesn't mean someone's always going to accept it or even ask. But if you're in a Christian, if you want to be happy, you've got to keep short accounts or it's going to just chew you up. Yeah, sometimes it's friendly fire. Who tried to kill Joseph? His brother sold him. David's own king tried to kill him and his own son. It was Judas that betrayed Jesus. The apostles fought among themselves, which of them was the greatest. Sometimes it's friendly fire. Cain kills Abel. And sometimes where forgiveness starts is right in the family. If we're going to grow like real Christians, if the world's going to testify, behold how they love each other. The Bible tells us forgiveness is not just a suggestion, it's a command. Well, let's return to our story. So when the fellow servants saw what had been done, they were very grieved and they came and told their master all that had been done. And then his master, after he had called him back in, he's been forgiven, he was set free, the debt was canceled, but it was still on the books. Now, has God forgiven our sins when we come to Jesus? But is there still a record? There's an investigation that finds out if we're passing on that forgiveness. See, in this, well, let me finish reading this and I'll comment on that. The master, after he'd called him in, this is verse 32, he said, you wicked servant. By the way, that's the strongest words that can be used. He was a servant of the king. And there's a lot of people that take the name of Christ. They say they serve the king and he will declare they're wicked. Why? Because they won't pass on the forgiveness they've received. He said, you wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt, 10,000 talents, because you asked me. What did he have to do to be forgiven? He asked. He said, shouldn't you have had mercy on your fellow servant just as I had compassion on you? How does God want us to forgive? The Bible says, even as Christ has forgiven you, so you ought to forgive one another. That's a supernatural forgiveness. How can we forgive like that? You can't without God's help and God's Spirit. And if it doesn't seem like it comes easy, you don't rest easy until it happens. You know why? Because God says, you ever read the Lord's Prayer? Forgive us our, depends on which version you're reading. One's forgive us our debts, the other's forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. It's funny how kids sometimes hear things. You know, before they can read, they hear. They hear you singing, bringing in the sheaves, and they think you're saying bringing in the cheese. He is the master and mighty, mighty king. They think he's a master mustard in everything. They hear all these interesting things. I heard about this one kid that they were saying, forgive us our trash baskets as we forgive those who trespass against us, instead of trespasses. But you know, the only commentary Jesus makes on the Lord's Prayer, after he's done with the Lord's Prayer, he says, for if you do not forgive each man his brother their trespasses, then neither will your Father in heaven forgive you yours. It cannot be any more direct. It cannot be misunderstood. But don't miss this. God is not saying, you all go forgive everybody, and then I'll forgive you. In the story, who does the first forgiving? The king. He says, now I have forgiven you freely, not based on what you do with others. I am going to first forgive you completely. Receive that forgiveness. And if you really receive the forgiveness that I am offering, that I am, who ends up paying that debt? The king does. Who pays for your sins? The king. After you receive that forgiveness, he says, now go pass it on. If after you've received all that kind of grace and mercy from God, you're going to go take each other by the throat, then he said, your forgiveness will be invalidated. Now, I don't know about you, but I don't want to stand before the Lord in the judgment owing 10,000 talents. It says, I better let it speak for itself. The master was angry. You ever heard of the wrath of the Lamb? What do you think makes Jesus so angry? When we're unmerciful with each other. The master was angry and delivered him to the tormentors, until he should pay all that was due him. Now, you know, we do believe in a lake of fire. We do believe punishment for the wicked. Some people say Seventh-day Adventists don't believe in hell. That's not true. We don't believe it burns forever. But we do believe there's a place of punishment. And the Bible says every man will be rewarded according to what is written in the books. That's why I want my sins under the blood of the Lamb. Don't you? It makes me shudder to think about going to the tormentors for 10,000 talents. How important is it that we learn to forgive each other, not only for your happiness in this life, not only for your witness, but for your own eternal benefit? It's not going to do you any good to have a vindictive and unforgiving spirit. Now, it doesn't come easy. Where do we get this? It's through looking at Christ we are transformed into his image. When you consider how much he's forgiven you, it doesn't come naturally. Naturally, we're selfish. You ever seen little kids? They fight and tussle with each other. You push me, I push you back. It's kind of a primal instinct that we all have to get even with others. As we mature, we become more sophisticated in the way we try to hurt each other. We do it with words and thoughts. I'd be embarrassed for you to see on my mental screen things I've concocted some extremely creative scenarios for people that hurt me. And I've had to ask God to forgive me about that and give me a pure heart. But sometimes we do it just in our heads. But really, it's all nurturing that unforgiving spirit when we need to pray for the mind of Christ. As Jesus has forgiven us, so we should forgive each other. You know, when I share this, I often like to repeat a familiar story about when Leonardo da Vinci was painting that famous mural of the Last Supper there in the chapel in Italy. He actually used live models. And he'd get, you know, different ones to stand in for Thomas and for the Apostle John. You know, it says in the Bible that John was on his right and Judas was on his left. It's pretty clear where they were sitting. And then Peter was beyond John. So John outlines actually where they sat during that supper. But at the time he was painting the mural, Leonardo da Vinci had a very public and a very bitter dispute with another famous artist named Michelangelo, of all things. They were contemporaries. They're both architects. They're both famous. And they probably were proud. But one began to criticize the work or the architecture of the other, and then they began to hurl letters back and forth, and these letters were public letters. You know, someone has an open letter. Open letters were sent back and forth, and it was in the tabloids of Italy, this kind of raging insults that were going back and forth between Leonardo and Michelangelo. And right about that time, Leonardo had a very creative idea. It came time to paint the face of Judas. So he got an idea. He didn't need Michelangelo to sit for him. He knew enough about what he looked like, and he very skillfully painted in the picture of Michelangelo's face there. He thought, I'm going to immortalize what a scoundrel he is. He put him in there in the place where Judas would normally be, his face, for the face of Judas. And that kind of, he was venting his spleen on that. That felt good, I guess, for a little while, but he had waited till last to paint the face of Jesus. And as he was trying to paint the face of Jesus, you know, he just kept painting something in. He said, that's not right. He had different models that came. And there's other stories to talk about when he found different models for Christ. But it went on for weeks. He kept trying different models and different faces, and he couldn't get the compassion and the love and the mercy of Jesus and that look in his eyes. And exasperated and desperate, he finally fell down and he knelt by his bed and he prayed and said, Lord, please show me the face of Jesus. And he heard a still small voice say, you will never see the face of Jesus until you change the face of Judas. And he realized, you know, and he went and he erased that, painted in whatever it is you're seeing today, whoever that was, poor guy. And then he finally got the picture of the love and the compassion of Jesus, and he put it in there. And sometimes we have had a hard time seeing the love and compassion of Jesus because we're immortalizing a scoundrel somewhere in our lives. We're bitter about something someone has done to us. You know, I was remembering last night as I was preparing this message. Any of you remember in 2006, there's an old order of Amish that lived back there in, Pennsylvania, that this shooter, this madman, took over a one-room schoolhouse and shot 10 young girls between 6 and 13, killing 5 of them, and then he committed suicide. And the media swooped down in on that, and they expected all kinds of outrage, and they were shocked by the reaction of this Amish community that went to the funeral of the shooter to comfort his family and his wife. Parents had just lost their daughters a few days earlier. And the media were dumbfounded. They didn't know how to comment on this. They couldn't understand it. They thought they were going to get everybody all stirred up and have these people quote and say something about gun laws and gun rights. And all they were talking about was, this is what Jesus would want us to do. Well, that's supernatural. How do you forgive somebody that takes your child? It's only through the Lord that can happen. How can God forgive us? Didn't we do something to his son? Aren't we all responsible for the cross? And yet, is he willing to forgive us? You know, I want to pray that God will help me have that kind of spirit, that kind of mind, don't you? It only comes from looking at Jesus and seeing what he paid for each of us.